going on? This is Daily, and you're checking out Your Music, My World.
So what's good, man? How are you?
Hey, I'm good. How are you?
I'm good, man. Thanks for asking. I'm very appreciative of you taking the time out to interview with me today.
No, of course. Thank you for having me.
So we're going to just get straight into it. So please explain how you got your start in the music industry.
I'm originally from Manchester, which is outside of London. It's like a smaller town. And I saved up a bunch of money. I worked, saved some money, and I moved down to London to kind of get myself into the big city. And basically just every night I would go out and perform at open mic nights and showcases and try and get my voice heard and my face seen by people. And I kind of started to make a little bit of a name for myself, and I got one of my very early demos, a song called Rainy Day, was played on the radio in the UK, and I then got asked by the radio station to do like a live session for them, which kind of got me out into the music industry. It kind of went from there. That was my first official release. I did a song with the Gorillaz called Don Chromatic in 2010, when I was still pretty much unknown, and then from there, I went on to kind of to write my mixtape, Those Who Wait, which is kind of what got me signed in the US in the end, because I had a song with Marsh Ambrose called The Learn Together, which seemed to have a really good reaction in the States, and that's kind of where I'm at.
Well, that's great to hear. I'm personally a huge fan of the mixtape. I downloaded it, so it's a pleasure speaking to you. So, what kind of artists and music did you grow up listening to? And did your parents help shape your musical taste?
Or was it down to your own discovery? My parents never really forced music on me. You know, well, not forced. You know, some people really influenced by their parents' music. I guess I am a little bit, but only by chance. Like, I'd say the artists that I kind of picked up on from their record collection would probably be people like Sade, George Michael, maybe even a bit of Luther or something, but it wasn't like they didn't embed it still any musical genre in me, you know, but it was a couple of those artists, but then I think a lot of it was just self-discovery, really. Like I really, when I was like a young teenager, I really liked commercial R&B, Usher, Aaliyah, Brandy.
Good taste.
Oh, thank you. And then that kind of, as I got a bit older, I kind of matured a bit into, I really like Neo Soul, Jill Scott, Erykah Badu, Maxwell, Bilal, and then I kind of took all that in, and then I guess, in my mid-teens, I discovered Prince, so that was kind of it, really. when I discovered Prince's music, that was just, it's kind of like a revelation to me, really, because it made me realize how there are just no boundaries to music. You know, you can do any genre, you can sing any way you want. You know what I mean? There's no creative boundary to what you can do. So, I'd say that. And then also, so it's kind of like definitely an American soulful R&B influence. And then, you know, my British influences, I'd say, are things like Radio, bands like Radiohead and Imogen Heap. And as I said, George Michael, and just, you know, this kind of UK influences that kind of, I think, blend with my style to make it what it is.
So now that you've released a mixtape and an EP, your fans want to know, and me being one of them, when's the album coming out, and what artists and producers have contributed to the formation of the album?
Well, the album is very, very nearly done, more or less. All the songs are more or less written now. I'm just kind of shaping the sound of it and getting it how I want it to sound. A mixture of UK and US producers. And in the UK, I've been working with a guy called Bernard Butler, who has a very kind of Britpop, like early 90s kind of background, which is very indie and not what you would associate with me, but we kind of, it's just been a really interesting project because we've come up with some really cool sounding stuff. So I'm excited about that. And then in the States, I've been working with Andre Harris, with Jay Vidal, who like Jill Scott's album, his Russia Confessions album. They've done, I mean, so much amazing stuff. And I've also been working with Shay Taylor, who does executive producing Beyonce's stuff. And so it's kind of a really, and then there are quite a few other producers on the album as well, just for one-off songs. But it's a really interesting mix of UK and US people, so it's I'm really excited about it, and it should be ready in springtime.
So what made you choose Jessie J for Remember Me?
Jessie's quite a good friend of mine. We met in London when we were both completely unknown, and like I said, when I was doing all that, I was going out every night and doing these shows, and she was kind of doing a similar thing, and we both met kind of before we were known, and I just loved her voice, and she loved what I was doing, and we kept in touch. And then obviously she blew up in the UK, and she came over to the States and everything, and I just think she's got an incredible voice, and we always said that when the right song came along, we would do it and have some fun with it. So when I wrote Remember Me, it just felt like the right thing for Jessie, so I just sent her a text and to see if she wanted to do it. And I didn't hear back from her for a couple of months because she's pretty busy. You know, she presents The Voice in the UK and all this stuff. And I was pretty much thought it wasn't going to happen. And then she kind of texted me about 2 days before it was going to radio. She was like, "Let's do it. I love the song. Let's do it." And so we just did it.
Well, it's definitely a great song. And I like the harmonies. You two have it near the end, so, and in the verses with her nice riffs and stuff. So definitely a great track right there. Now, this is interesting. You describe your sound as future throwback soul. So explain exactly what you mean by that.
Yeah. Future throwback soul is a term that I came across about a year ago. I'd always get asked in interviews, you know, somewhat going to sound in three words. And I'd just be like, I don't know, it's hard to say that, you know, on the spot. But so anyway, so I found this phrase, and I just thought it's perfect because it's like, it is what I do. I hate to be, when people say soul, I don't like it when people just assume that means retro or it means like old kind of, you know what I mean? People think it's a kind of an old genre, and it is, and it's been around, but it's not. Soul reincarnates itself in every time, you know, every decade kind of thing, and it's never, the essence of it is always there. So basically with my music, what I try to do is, create something that feels like it's from the present time or even from the future, but, you know, keeping the core of it being, you know, stuff that people know and love about soul music, so real lyrics, you know, real vocals and feelings and emotions. So I guess that's what I mean by future throwback soul. It's the future and the past.
And your mixtape, it got so much critical acclaim from the public, and very deservedly so. So how did you react to it being received so well, especially since you were included in the BBC's Sound of 2011?
It was very gradual, to be honest. It wasn't like, it was a very gradual process, but it was amazing because when I first put it out, I was like, I set myself a target of about, I think, I said to myself, like, within a year, I want to get 5,000 downloads, you know, and we'll see what happens. And, you know, it's now, like, I think it's over 150,000 or something, so it's like, It's a lot more than I ever expected, and it's just been amazing. It made me realise that, you know, you can't really sit on songs. Like, I have a lot of songs that are just on my hard drive that I haven't released because I always think it's not the right time or it's not the right thing. But I think it made me realise that, you know, you don't realise how special some songs are until you play them to people and they tell you how much they love them. So it's... I was amazed by the reception that it got all over the world. I'm hoping for a new mixtape before Christmas, so I'm trying to pull that together now.
That's cool. And pretty much perhaps the standout track and the song you're most well known for at the moment is probably Alone Together. So how did that collaboration with Marsha come about?
That happened, I was doing some writing in New York, and I was just at the studio, and we heard that Marsh was in town, and obviously I was a fan, and you know, I loved what she did with Flowetry and the stuff that she's been doing since then. And And yeah, I've just said to my manager, let's see if she's available. So her manager got in touch with, my manager got in touch with her manager, and she liked it, so she came down. And it's a little bit strange, because when you I've never met her before, so it's kind of strange going in a room with someone you don't know and just writing a song. But we were definitely on the same vibe, I think, that day. So and the ideas we had really flowed together, so it was just a great, fun session.
As a new breaking artist, let's be honest, is commercial success important to you, or do you not really care?
I wouldn't say I don't care. I think it's important to me in the sense that, being realistic in the music industry today, if you want to have a degree of, if you want your music to reach the maximum amount of people, and you want to have a lasting career, I think it's important to have a degree of commercial success. And, for the amount of work that I put into my music, I think it deserves that. It deserves me to give it that kind of chance, to shine like that. So, yeah, I do, I would like that. but never at the sacrifice of what is at the core of the music and what people, I always want to keep at the forefront what people originally